Get hype, get hype, get hype. All right, let's go.
That's a good way to lead in, Steven.
Oh, we're recording?
Yeah, we're recording. Yeah.
Welcome to the show, Steven.
We were doing a rally clap.
Yeah, we were like rallying the troops. Yeah.
Before every show, we do a rally clap. And this is the first time it's been recorded.
We put our hands in and say, go, 2 weeks.
It's been so long. We get our hands in the middle of the table with Dan.
Well, Dan lays on the table. We put all our hands on Dan. It's really awkward.
And then we pull out his nipple rings.
Exactly. I mean, but it's awkward, but it seems to get us rallied.
Definitely.
Sure.
Good job, Todd.
You're welcome.
Anyway, I enjoyed dinner last night.
It was amazeballs.
Thanks for reaching for the check.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. I had the Tyrannosaurus Rex arms.
It was nice.
I can't seem to get it.
Take my strong hand.
You know what's funny, Steven?
I was going to get the check, Jared. Dang it.
Not only did Todd get taken out to lunch yesterday...
Yeah, but that was like a business meeting lunch.
Yes, it was.
When it's business, I let you pay for it.
I know,
just
we
us
know
going
that.
Out to lunch.
I got that.
Yeah.
When's the last time Todd paid for something?
Oh, this is the first thing he does.
Oh, it's because Jared never shuts up about business.
Yeah, but...
Yeah,
so
exactly.
When I go up to his way to eat on like a Sunday, the rare occasion where we don't invite you, and I go and we meet at Dock
Which
Street...
Which is a great idea, by the way.
When Perfect I meet at idea. Dock Street, Todd's like, I got this. I'm like, gee, thanks, Todd.
It's like a $10 check.
I always tell people, if you make the trek out to West Philadelphia, I'll probably pay.
In West Philadelphia, born and raised.
Exactly. I tried to tell Morgan how cool that was, by the way, the other day. Not impressed.
Todd,
really?
Before not I get impressed. I was like, you realize you're West Philadelphia, born and raised.
Da-da.
And she's aware of where that's
Da-da.
From.
Stop it. I'm not saying that in my video.
She knows it's Fresh Prince and all that, right?
Yeah, she did.
So before we jump
zero.
Into
wow. zero fucks.
That's her funny. YouTube into her YouTube channel and I do an intro.
Yeah.
She should you should do a reenactment.
I tried. I'm telling you
I will tell
I tried
her.
To Yeah, that's
I'll sign
work.
Up as sure. Lonely Girl 17 or Tween Girl 22.
Well, you already own that, don't you?
Cat Lover
already?
26.
I love Tween
I'll,
girls,
I'll use,
no,
wait. You know what? I'll just sign up on the accounts I use to dislike your videos.
Yeah,
I
thank
have like,
you.
That's I have about I 15 that I use.
That or, one dislike that Morgan has is
She should
mine.
Do that. She should do that, Todd. That would be funny. But anyway, let's get to intro. Jared Polin, FroKnowsPhoto.com, and welcome to Raw Talk episode number 214 as we venture along to 269. Which is a long way away because we do it every
well,
other
week. It
depends
week. On how many drinks I give her.
So it's going to take how many more weeks? It's going to take lots of weeks to get there. But people ask, why don't you do it every week? Why don't you do it? You know, it's been really good getting to do it
long,
every other week, though.
Yeah.
No, but I will say, though, the spike of downloads is like a third better
sure.
than when it was every other week. Because I think people now know... Oh shit! I need to go listen to it because it's not every week, so it gives some incentive
yeah.
to listen. So that's that. Anyway, why yeah. don't we talk about what's some updates? We released Nikon D3400 users guide.
Yes, and we have a couple more in the can too coming out.
Yep, we've got a M5.
Correct.
We've got a D5600,
which is a nice camera.
It is a very nice camera. When
it
I held on to that,
so it almost feels like the M5 body too, mirrorless wise.
For a DSLR, and
yeah.
and so a lot of what. The goal is to put those out. We always put those out in the past, but the idea is to put more out as these cameras come out. We get our hands
Every
on them.
Every time a new camera
We put
comes
it
out.
Into the world.
Yep.
It's a free user's guide. They're anywhere between 35 minutes and an hour, depending on how much I talk.
Well, we try and go through the outside of the camera, the physical buttons. We go inside the menu and how you should properly set it. We also go into live view mode,
yeah.
still shooting, all that kind of
so
stuff.
We've
the
got,
info screen.
We've got that. We also had the Jigunda Huge Super Mega Giveaway Extravaganza contest.
Yes.
I still get emails. Who won? Well,
I love that they comment on other videos that aren't related to the Jigunda contest.
Yeah. Well, but like they missed it. Just go look.
Look in your video feed.
Or look in the feed.
Yeah.
Go to the website.
Jerry, can I call you personally and ask you?
No. Follow me on YouTube. Sorry.
Who's this?
I don't know who this is going to be.
Yeah, hello, Jared. I was just wondering, I submitted my, for the Jigunda contest, and I was wondering if I won it all. If you could, please send me my prize. I'll be behind the dumpster at Taco Bell. Goodbye. Thank you.
I don't even know what to say after that.
It's been a while since we heard from Becky.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, all these. And on the email list. If you're on the email list and you open it up, you'll see that came out anyway. The winner was this kid, Aiden, so happens to be a teenager.
Perfect.
And
he was great.
Yeah.
I gave him a fifth option instead of, you know, the three bodies or glass. I gave him a fifth option that was probably better instead of going with a D810.
A girlfriend? Definitely. Oh, sorry.
D810 would have just been a body with no lenses. Yeah. So I was like, I recommend a D750. Or whatever, D500. I let him choose between full frame
or
crop.
Sure, the equivalent of, what, $3,000 or whatever you're offering?
Yeah, he looked it up. He's like, all right, D750 and maybe an 85. I'm like, all right, so there's an 85-1.8 I can get at Allen's. And then I was like, what else? You need something wider. He's like, well, there's a 24-1.8. I'm like, well, Allen has one of, at Allen's, they have one of those used. Mm. So I got that, which saved $250, $300.
Half my glasses used, yeah.
So that's what he got. And I sent him a bag, and I sent him a shirt, and I sent him lens cloths. So that's the Jigunda super huge
mega.
You
should do a follow-up with these people, like a year after later. The fact. Like, I'd love to see what they did with that camera.
Like Gloria.
Well, Gloria.
Yes, Gloria. What have you done? What have you done, Gloria?
Gloria, send us a video, because I know Gloria watches, because she still comments all the time. She comments on my photos. So, Gloria.
I have a crush on Gloria.
She probably sold it on eBay like the first week.
Exactly.
Yeah, I got it. I sold it.
Cha-ching.
Yeah, I was like, thank you, FroKnowsPhoto.
Gloria.
I decided to go another direction, Jared. Sorry, I smoked it.
Yeah, Gloria. Anyway, so there's that. That's
what did he have, by the way? An Olympus camera or something?
An Olympus OEM Micro Four Thirds something.
Still a solid camera.
He
didn't have
fine.
The glass for any Nikon, right?
No, he had no. He didn't have anything yet. But I know his parents shoot a little bit, and
nice.
And he also said. No, his photos were pretty good for... It doesn't matter what you have. We always say that.
It took us a while to reach out to him, too, remember?
Well, I sent him emails and he thought that they were just regular emails that I always send.
Because we had to like kind of trick him because we want to get his real reaction on camera.
When I realized that he's a teenager, I'm like, hey, how about we call on Skype and I film you? I was like, I couldn't do that. So
well,
I had to
get his mom's permission.
I had to get his mom to say, yes, this is fine, or
sure.
A parent, because... I mean,
she probably shouldn't have called him and been like, hey, can I get you on Skype, by the
hey,
way?
You want a video chat?
Want a video chat number? With me? Yeah.
So, hey, you guys on MySpace?
Don't worry about being 25 years younger than me.
Don't wear your pants either.
Whoa, Steven. I mean, Steven, really?
God.
Really, Steven?
I'm just saying what
that
she
is
said
not
to
even
him.
What
That's
I was
all.
Insinuating.
Horrible.
Are you speaking at CPAC?
My Gear Vault update. There's been a lot of people that... signed up for the getting proposals and stuff. And so many people signed up for the proposals so quick that we overwhelmed our insurance partner. they had to put extra people on our account because I don't understand in the insurance antiquated world of their
They
business,
underestimated the fro bump, by the way.
How are they're ill prepared for when somebody can bring them 100 things in a matter of days?
Sure.
And they're used to getting like...
I get it.
No, I get it, but I don't understand how the insurance... I mean, this is our goal, is to...
Of course.
You know, to do this good stuff.
Yeah.
And for them not to be fully prepared, they had to add extra people to work on it so they could kick the reports back.
Do you not know who I am?
So
Jared Polin.
We like to say 24 to 48 hours. If it's been taking a while, you know that it's taking a while because we overwhelmed their antiquated system. And hopefully changes will be made. And Android will be out, we're hoping, in roughly 4 months.
With the Android update, it's going to be immense. It's going to be no problem.
It's going to be
smooth sailing. Make sure you sign up at donaldpolin.com.
So,
I'm starting a new website, by the way. It's called Comb Over Nose Photo. And check me out there. Thank you.
China. thanks for that. Yeah, so that's My Gear Vault. If you haven't downloaded it at this point, don't. Just kidding.
What?
MyGearVault.com. Android in the future, get it right, get it out. Then we're on both systems. And then it's go to town time.
Then it's time to put
promotion.
It on my sidekick.
My next tail.
Exactly.
What's her name in the movie?
Who?
Funny thing about my back.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and super
Jules.
Bad. She,
Jules.
Yeah, but her friend had a sidekick.
Her friend had a sidekick.
The funny thing about my back, it's on my...
It on my...
Hey, no, that's a bleep, Dan.
That's a bleep.
You bleep that sexual stuff.
Sexual
I do not want the
bleep.
Feminists yelling at me again.
We've got to do the viewing party.
Here,
I've got the unrated version.
I'll censor it. So the funny thing about my back is on my...
You definitely butchered that.
Yeah, you suck, Todd. just shut up. Dan, disconnect his microphone. All right, let's get to photo news. Photo news is not brought to you by anybody, but if it was to be brought to you by anybody, it would probably be my gear vault.
A new satellite startup company called Planet aims to take 51 terapixel images of Earth daily. Now, that's a 50 trillion pixel image once it's stitched together every single freaking day.
Wait, is that
Did
like
they
a Relonk?
It's not like a Relonk. 50 trillion pixel image.
How's that work?
They're going to basically take one terapixel image each day.
How?
They have a satellite.
Yeah, but does the satellite take one terapixel image, or does it have to move and then they stitch it together?
They have, I think, 60 they're going to send up there. Let me finish this. Let me get
into it. I was just asking questions.
Now, the company, they already have about 60 small CubeSat satellites, what they call them, orbiting around the world. But earlier this month, they more than doubled that number. And
wait, how many did they start with?
They had about 60.
Wow. So if we double that, hold on.
More than double.
Hold on, I'm counting here. 60 doubled. So that's like, take six,
it's
Common
like,
Core.
It's like 45.
Common Core math, which I know nothing about. I couldn't even fake guessing. So there's 10 sixes.
It's 120!
All right, 121, because it's more than doubled.
Sure.
All right, they sent about 80 up.
Oh.
About 80 Dove satellites.
80 extra or on top of the 60?
80 extra.
Wait, hold on. That's...
Jesus.
9, 10, 11, 12, 13... That's 140.
Yep. So they should be fully operational come this summer, sending back the giant images again daily. And Google has also handed over its fleet of 7 Terabella high-res satellites.
They sold them.
For that company to run, to this company.
Yeah, because they didn't want to be in the sat game
exactly.
anymore.
Exactly. Oh. And as part of that deal, Planet, that company, will give Google access to its growing archive of imagery, those terapixel images, for at least the next few years. Huh. I mean, a terapixel.
Damn.
That's... insane. A giant
Yeah, but you know the great thing about terapixel? We could upload that in like 12 seconds here at the factory.
50 trillion pixels, one image.
We'd upload
you
that
You know what's
in
funny about
second.
A terapixel? It's located on my...
back of my camera.
There's a new creative Netflix original series called Abstract,
yes!
The Part of Design.
Yes.
You saw this, right?
Yes.
The new 8-episode series helps viewers appreciate the arts a little more, focusing on the details of...
It's really all about
the story.
What's your story?
Yes. The details of 8 of the most creative thinkers and imaginative minds working in the world of art and design today. So not Todd Wolf. It includes a photographer, a graphic designer, illustrator, a Nike shoe designer, an automotive designer, an architect, an interior designer, and a stage designer.
It's very similar.
Whole lots of designers.
It's very similar to Chef's Table. If you watched Chef's Table on Netflix, it follows 8, maybe the first season was 6, world-renowned chefs, and it's cinematically beautiful. This is very similar. I watched the one on Platon. What's his name? Platon?
Platon, I think. Yeah, however, P-L-A-T-O-N.
They call him Platon, I guess. I don't know how he actually says it.
That's the only photographer featured on this show.
I watched that one.
I still have to see it.
That was great. Yeah. And then Maddie wanted to watch the one about the architect. That was awesome as well.
I want to watch the one who makes all the Jordan shoes.
Yeah, I'm
going to
watch them all. Yeah. The abstract thing.
I haven't seen that one yet either.
Yeah.
Love net.
Because Michael Jordan's in it.
Oh, yeah. I watched the one about the graphic design. It was about fonts.
Was
super
it cool?
Interesting. Super interesting.
Faulkner font?
Yeah.
And you can see that full trailer over on the website, and you can watch it now via Netflix.
FroKnowsPhoto.com/episodes. RawTalk-214.
Then we've got
and
camera.
Jared's Netflix account is sign in is, oh, sorry.
Camera conversion.
You should see the picture of me for that. It's my Facebook profile, so it's just me, the shot Steven took me of Keira Knightley.
You love that picture.
I love that picture.
You're welcome.
Look at me.
I can't wait till we print that out on the big Canon printer, the Pro 4000, because we'll crop in from the sides because it's all white, and we're going to make it really long, and it's just going to be me, and we're going to hang it from the outside of the Fro factory.
Did you just say crop?
In. Because it's a white background.
No. You don't crop my images. Nobody crops my images.
Exactly.
Okay, so that brings up the point I made a note about and didn't talk about.
Yeah.
I put out a rant on Facebook, and it was kind of... I did some photos recently, and I'm going to...
Hold on, Dave.
Buckle your seatbelts. Here comes another ranty Mick Ranterson.
God, Dave Leno. Dave Leno, everybody. Moving up
in
the world.
More.
Exactly.
Well, it's coming up on March Madness. He's probably going to be doing a lot of ESPN games. So I took these awesome photos of these kids, and I sent them to the people. Usually it's family, friends, and acquaintances. Now, you send them photos, and you don't go through the whole process of, hey, don't crop, don't edit, don't do a filter, don't do anything stupid before you put these out into the world.
Sure.
and you don't want to have the discussion because you don't want to create an issue. But it's really upsetting and frustrating when they take the photo and they send it. But these photos are great, and they made a collage, and they take one image that was shot with a specific way.
Composition, yeah.
The composition was what made the image,
sure.
And now it got smushed to this, to half a frame, and they don't see anything wrong with it because they're not creatives and they're not
photographers. They're focused on the subject, not the
exactly.
composition.
But my whole thing is, when I deliver an image, and when you deliver an image, you use your creative mindset to edit it, to tweak it, to do what you wanted to do with
it. Spend time with it, yeah.
Before you send it to them. So it's bad form for somebody to tweak it and put a filter over it and then put it out, and especially if they tag you and it looks like balls. Now, it's not worth the argument. I'm not going to have the discussion with them because it's not worth the argument. On the flip side, when you're doing a job, you can say to people not to do it. It's easier there. And on the flip side, what I also say is that if you're paying me for the work and you're saying you have a vision for how you would like to edit it and you let me know, well, you're paying for it.
Do what you want.
Then
yeah.
that's, yes, go yeah. for it. Because that's what they're paying for. But
yeah.
it's just very frustrating to, and a lot of people say, yeah, bands do this all the time. They take their image and they take a screen grab and you can see the rest of their phone. And then they put a shitty filter and then they draw on it. It's like, oh, it's like that guy.
Respect my photographer.
Oh, it's like
Prince. Yeah, Richard Prince.
Richard Prince.
Yeah.
Dick Prince.
Dick Prince.
Yeah. It's like Dick Prince just taking your stuff. It's
like
frustrating.
I will say I'd rather at least have them, if they're going to do something, crop it versus putting like an Instagram filter or something on it. That is what really annoys
yeah.
me.
I yeah. mean, I get that in certain places they don't know how to put it full frame up on Instagram, but
I don't think I would make a big deal out of them personally, but I understand your rant.
That's why I brought it to everybody.
Exactly.
And I mean,
just cut them off. Never talk to them again.
The reason I bring it yeah. to everybody is because I know that people are in the same boat.
Yeah.
And it's not worth the argument or the discussion to say, hey, don't crop it. Because then it's going to be like, but it's my image. You took them of my kids. And
Mom, I'm never taking a picture of you again.
Yeah.
Back to photo news. Camera conversion company Max Max, they modified the Fuji X-Pro 1 and the X100S. They created a monochrome version, which is similar to Leica's M monochrome, but for about a third of the price.
Mm.
President Dan Llewellyn says, to convert a camera to monochrome, we take the camera apart, remove the sensor cover glass, which is epoxied to the ceramic package. Then we use special equipment to remove about 5 microns from the surface of
All
the
right,
sensor,
you know what,
removing
Dan's
the micro lenses and the color filter array.
Dan, shut up and just release your damn camera and say it just works. You don't want to know
yeah.
the rest.
Basically, they just removed the color filter. That's all he had to say.
But I thought they said they took the sensor out.
Well, yeah, but they have to do that to get to the color filter, and then they, yeah.
Oh. Back in the day, Fuji made the Fuji S3 and the Fuji S5 Pro.
Mm-hmm.
It was based off of the Nikon D200 body, and so it was a 12-megapixel sensor. They took out the Nikon sensor, and they put in a 12-megapixel sensor of their design that had 6 up and 6 down. It had 6 megapixels for the highlights and 6 megapixels for the shadows, and it made this really incredible, punchy image.
Hmm.
Fuji did an
Crush
awesome
the
job
max.
There. The problem was the menu system. They got rid of the Nikon and they had their own Fuji menu system, which looked like ball sack. And it was really slow and clunky, but it gave some beautiful images. They also released like they would take the filters off of it to make it, what's that?
Like infrared or something?
Infrared. That's the word I was looking for.
I
don't know what that has to do with this, but Fuji S Pro 5, S5 Pro, Richie owned.
When the Leica M monochrome first came
out. Can you fix your bow tie? It is crooked.
Is that good?
No. Now you got to shift it that way.
That's better. Shoulders are weak.
When the Leica M monochrome first came out, Fuji basically said, what are you doing?
There's no trademark on your iShoot RAW right there, so I was just...
Can you, like, pay attention to me at all today?
The funny thing about the trademark is that it's located on my...
It's actually right on the breast on that one. Go ahead,
That's
Steven.
The problem.
I'll pay attention.
He's got
no, he's got no breast meat.
When it first came out, Fuji said they would respond if the market's out there for a black and white camera, but they never did, so that's why Max Max came out and they released this camera.
So what's his first name?
Who?
Max?
Max Max, that's the company.
Mm. His last name?
Max. Two first names.
Huh.
Yeah.
I knew this kid named Devin Scott.
Don't care.
Yeah, never trust people with two first names.
No.
Yeah.
Never.
Never at all.
This one, again, is going to come in for about a third of the price of the Leica M monochrome, which is $7,400. This will be $2,400 for the X-Pro 1M.
Poor man's Leica.
And $2,600 for the X100S. Pretty much. Poor man's Leica.
Or you could just shoot RAW and then convert it to monochrome.
You could,
later.
But this is going to be sharper.
Sure.
And it's also more sensitive to light, so.
In fact, it's going to give you a sharper image.
Ooh. I see what you did there.
Used to love going there as a kid.
Yeah.
You ever go into the Sharper Image store?
Yes, actually, I have.
They just to get a massage.
You'd get the Shiatsu chair, and as a kid, you'd go around playing with everything.
You know what I watched the other day? Blank Check.
Blank Check is amazing.
I thought it was terrible. Now, as a kid, don't get me wrong, I thought it was the best movie in the world.
Mr. McIntosh?
Movie ever. I watched it again, though, as an adult, and I'm like, this movie is so bad.
There are some movies you should never watch. You should watch them in your mind.
Exactly.
Well, she's still hot.
She's still hot, yes. It's still very creepy that she's like 30 years old and kissing like a 10-year-old.
He was like 15. Mm. No, he's like 12.
No, he's like 10 or 11 in that
Do you know
movie.
Tone Loke's in that movie, right?
Yeah. But Sharper Image, I bring that up because Sharper Image is one of the like big 18-wheelers that came in and dropped
all the toys.
And, yeah.
That's called product placement.
Yeah.
Funky Cole Medina.
Blank Check was, I love that movie.
It was a classic.
Funky.
Don't watch it when you're older.
And me as Tone Loke, I was also an Ace Ventura. Thank you.
Did you know how Tone Loke got that voice?
Smoking cigarettes with Barbara Kensington.
I believe his grandmother used to give him the whiskey or something. Something burned his vocal cords as a kid.
Yes.
Don't quote me on that. I think I saw it somewhere on Behind the Music.
You definitely made that up.
Google it. Dan, do some research and then fact check at the end of the show.
It was my wild thing.
Now, if you really want to go...
Hey, give me an 808. Cruising down. No, wait.
Sorry.
How'd the song go?
Steven's going to snap.
Funky Cole Medina.
I'm just going to not do photo news anymore.
No, this is really
pointless.
Good, Steven. This is really good.
Oh, it's great, man. It's great. I love it.
Hey, can we get back to photo news?
Seriously, yeah. Let's get back to photo news.
We do
news.
It every 2 weeks. So at least let me give me my 20 minutes of photo news, please.
2 weeks.
A new Kickstarter called Lab Box.
Is it started by Max Max?
Your film right at home. The new Lab Box allows users to process both 120 and 35 millimeter film. It has a modular design, so one format can be swapped out for the other, and it's very compact. They say you can easily fit it in your bag, your purse, your backpack, whatever.
Well, how do you load the film into it?
Here's
Does
how
it
works.
Come with a...
You basically open the box, you attach the film to the reel, you close the box, and then you begin to transfer the film onto the spool. Then you simply pour the chemicals in and you agitate it for about 10 seconds every minute. It's pretty straightforward, but there's no need to get the dark bag out and transfer your film.
How do you agitate
right
it? Interrupt its news?
Wait, how much is this?
This is for an early bird pledge of $84. You'll get one lab box and one module, or for $116, you'll get both modules.
What is a module?
Again, one of them is going to be a 120 millimeter module, and the other one's a 35 millimeter. If you want to switch film
formats, are they selling the chemicals?
They offer chemicals,
so
you can put any chemicals you want in it.
But so I can get the chemicals through them?
Yes, they offer a mono bath that has all the chemicals you need mixed in, ready to go, and you can do it.
Well,
right
does
there.
It come as powder?
No,
can
and then
I
you
possibly
mix it?
Smoke any of it?
Because I remember back in school, you would heat the water to like 90 some degrees, and then they would pour the packets of the Kodak. And then you'd stir. I mean, there was a whole process. And then if you process your film, so here's the thing: if you want less grain, well, I'm not gonna. Don't quote me on it, but I know that if your developer's too hot, it's going to process the film, develop it much quicker, which is going to add and introduce more noise and more grain into the film.
Oh yeah,
I want to order this. I think
it's not bad price wise.
No, I want to try it.
And they had the initial goal of $74,000 for this Kickstarter campaign. It's already well surpassed that at about $225,000.
And where
at the time
is it located?
Of this recording. Oh, I'm not sure where it's located.
Can somebody make a note for me to go do that?
And you can see their full Kickstarter promo video over on the website.
One of the most
dark room needed.
One of the most cathartic things. In the dark room was going into the to
Use
transfer
condoms.
The film.
Yeah.
To transfer the film. And there were two types of reels, the plastic reel and the metal reel. I sucked at the metal reel because with the metal reel, which was the old sort, you had to get it in there into the clip. And then you had to rotate it like this without getting kinks in the film. And then it would go around there. And if film stuck together and didn't get developer on it, it wouldn't develop in that spot and you would screw it up. Now, the plastic wheels had these balls in there and you would slide it in this way and you would rotate like this. And it would take the film as you did it and do the same thing. And at the very end, you had to make sure the tape was still not stuck to it because the teacher used used to do bulk loading, and at the end there would be tape, so it would be stuck to the reel, and then you take the tape off. You have to make sure that that didn't fall back in, because if that was on the emulsion, it wouldn't develop. And man, I loved going into the darkroom to do that.
Yeah, this one basically is just a small little box, probably about, say, this high.
That's awesome.
And you start getting the film out, you place it inside, you place it on the reel, close it, spin it, and then it latches onto the reel, and then you just pour the chemicals in, and voila, you're set.
Yeah, I'd like to try that.
Yeah.
And get some film and do that. And it's great business model.
Easy.
If they're going to, what they should do is a, well, be able to sell it, of course, and sell chemicals.
I'm curious how much the chemicals are they sell, though. I didn't see that in the Kickstarter campaign. I didn't look very well, but...
Yeah, because, well, chemicals are expensive to ship.
Yeah.
Because it's chemicals.
Well, chemicals are expensive in general, yeah.
And black and white is expensive because it has silver.
Yep.
And you recover the silver.
I remember the silver tanks we had at the lab. It was a pain in the ass.
Cool.
Yeah.
I like that one.
Then we've got Sigma. They've once again impressed the industry with three new art lenses this past week, introducing the Sigma 14 f1.8, 135 f1.8, and 24-70 f2.8 OS. All the lenses feature their hypersonic motor,
yeah.
And the 24-70 features OS, and the lenses will equal out to a total of 7 lenses now in their art lineup.
Huh.
They say the 14mm is perfect for astrophotography, the 135 is going to be great for portraits, and the 24-70 is just going to be that all-around workhorse, which you should replace your 24-70 finally one day.
It's special to me.
I would buy the I'd buy the Canon 24-70 version 2 is super sweet.
Oh yeah, of course. But this is going to be, I'm sure, much
less
more affordable.
Yeah.
They'll be available in full frame mounts for Canon, Nikon, and Sigma bodies, and unfortunately,
you know,
no
for all
price,
those people that own a Sigma camera.
Yeah, no
none.
Price or availability has been announced just yet for these lenses.
They also announced a 100-400.
I was just getting that 100-400 f5 to 6.3 contemporary lens, which again, same thing, no price. It's kind of similar to the 150 to 600,
right?
Though,
but I think
which is also contemporary.
What I read from some other people, they talked about it being lighter, like a light lens.
I thought it said it was about 2.5 pounds, which I thought the contemporary was about 2 pounds, the 150 to 600.
Well, there were two of those, and one was like
the
4 pounds,
four,
and one was 6.
But the contemporary, I thought it was 2 pounds.
I think one was 6 pounds.
But I thought one was 2.
Oh.
I could be wrong. It could be 4.
I could look it up.
I thought it was 5.
I'll look it up. Keep going.
I thought it was 5 pounds.
But again, no pricing just yet for any of those lenses. I'm curious what the 14 is going to be, because that's a lot of glass.
Maybe 1,500 bucks.
And the 135 1.8 too. That's a whole lot of glass.
I don't know what that's going
to
be, but people
said...
Compared
to your Nikon 105-14, that's what, $2,200?
Expensive.
Yeah.
What some people said was that the Canon 135 f2 is what, $1,000?
Is that an L lens?
I think it is.
Is it? Okay, I wasn't sure if that was an L lens or not.
I'm looking this up so I can get the weight.
Yeah, yeah.
This is the contemporary version.
The 150 to 600 you're looking up?
Yeah. B&H is super good with putting up everything
specs.
About this.
Oh,
specs.
Great. Yep.
The contemporary is 4.3 pounds.
It's 4. So the other one's 6.
The other one's even more heavy.
So yeah, this is about 2.5 pounds, they say.
All right, so that's what they mean by lighter.
Way lighter.
Is that it's much lighter, and people can carry that around.
That's not bad. Then we've got the infamous assassination photo taken by AP photographer Burhan Azbiliki of an assassin holding a gun over top of Russian ambassador Andriy G. Karlov's body. He's been awarded the press photo of the year.
I think everybody said that, and that's going to be a Pulitzer
definitely.
Prize-winning photo.
Definitely. It's a powerful photo.
It's just one of those images. I mean, it's just one of those
and
damn images.
While everybody ran, he kept snapping away, which is scary, but he kept taking pictures.
That's insane.
That photo is, I mean, that's...
I'd be out.
Yeah.
And then they killed that guy. That
yeah,
guy
I mean,
died.
The fact that you fight...
He was an undercover cop, too, or something, right? Or
no, he was
cop.
An off-duty cop.
Yeah.
But, of course, there's always this conspiracy that Russia did it on purpose, blah, 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 blah.
Just the fact that he could fight his flight like instinct and continue to do that. I mean, that's insane.
I wonder if you even realize what's going on, you know, until, like, after it's over. Like, I just...
It might have been one of those things,
like,
I am insane that just happened.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
It just goes by so fast. You don't even think about it.
Yeah. And it could have happened so fast. Like, he got the shot, but, you know,
he's still
moments
shaking
later,
it's
over. Yeah.
So there's been obviously much criticism surrounding the decision for giving this the
Why?
Press photo of the year.
Why?
As it's quite a graphic image.
Why? What are we going to... What are we going to not show graphic images? We have to play.
So here's what they say.
Play it safe so people.
No, I agree. Jury member Mary F. Calvert, she says it was a very, very difficult decision, but in the end, we felt that the picture of the year was an explosive image that really spoke to the hatred of our times. And then on the flip side, Stuart Franklin, who is the jury's chairman, he says he did not vote for the image because he was afraid it somehow amplified a terrorist message.
I mean, we show video and pictures of dropping the bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
There's video of this.
Yeah, there's video of that. Yeah. It's just like, you can't...
It's life.
You can't take away...
You can't sanitize the bad.
Yeah.
Because if you forget the past, you're bound to repeat it. And so that's... I'm trying to think of the terms, because last time I used terms on Facebook, the feminist struck and said I can't use that term anymore because it means that that's actually strong, but I was talking about a cat running away in fear, not a female body part, but I understand I got to pick different words.
Remember the past or you're bound to repeat it.
Well, yeah, but I'm thinking about the word I can use for babies. Babies. We can't baby everybody. Kid gloves.
Yeah.
Extremely offended by that.
Yeah, kid gloves. So yep. Somebody's going to take offense because they had to wear gloves as a kid.
So you can find a link to this
freezies.
Photo.
Freezies. Did you have freezies?
Freezies.
Steve, Todd, do you have freezies?
Nope.
You know what freezies were?
No.
They were the gloves that in the cold, the ski guy would show up or when they got wet.
Oh, yeah.
Freezies.
I had underwear like that, so I knew when I had a problem at night.
Underoos. Underoos, Todd.
No, they would change color when they got wet.
Yeah, they turned yellow.
Yeah.
Yeah. How'd you know?
I knew because I had the... No, I never had
my
that problem.
My mom said they were special.
Yeah, they were special because Todd had My Little Pony ones.
They were all yellow.
So on the website, I'll link over to the bio of the photographer. You can also see his camera settings used for the image as well as the actual final photo that, again, won the press photo of the year. And a couple more news stories. We've got Canon. They announced a trio of entry-level cameras. This was right after Raw Talk weeks ago.
Is that one? That's three, right?
Carry correct. The one. Yeah.
The Rebel T7i, the 7070.
Same camera.
Pretty much. And the new EOS M6. Now, spec-wise, the T7i and 7070, like you said, are nearly identical on the inside and only really differ with some physical buttons on the outside. Notable specs include the same 24.2 megapixel APS-C sensor that Canon's been toying with for the past year. However, they upgraded these with the Digic 7 processor, and they now shoot 6 frames per second as well. Mm. And ISO finally has a massive bump in the Rebel series, ranging from 100 to 25,600 natively, which is pretty big. Mm. Also a big leap in the AF system. Both cameras now feature 45 autofocus points. The big thing here is that they're all cross-type. Now, the 80D, I believe, also has that system. And that's more cross-type sensors than the 5D4.
Well,
now
full
it's
frame
a different.
Versus,
it's right. Full frame and it's a different focusing system, but still, that's a lot of cross-type autofocus points. And the cameras have also been upgraded with their new dual-pixel AF system that we all love. I will say Canon has finally packed a punch in their Rebel series, because usually Nikon always has that high-end, low-end camera,
yeah.
If that makes sense.
Yeah.
But Canon this time really did a good job.
That is T7i. How you fight. That is how you fight, by the way.
And now some minor differences. The 77D offers the same metering system as the 80D, along with Canon's anti-flicker mode, which the T7i doesn't offer. It also houses a top LCD screen that nobody uses that I know of.
Well, Rob at the camera store was very upset about Nikon's getting rid of top LCDs.
Really? I don't know anyone that uses it.
He's like, but I'm so... I'm like, Rob, you're old and antiquated. You need to stop worrying about that and get with the times. All of the information is either in the camera
viewfinder,
or it's on the back of your... It's all right here.
I mean, whether you have an EVF or a viewfinder, yeah, it's all... Everything is in there that you need. Now, also, this one has a back button focus button.
You'll never use that.
Could cause many people to jump to this specific model versus the T7i. It also has a jog dial where the T7i just has a D-pad, so you can't really scroll through pictures or switch aperture real fast. T7i comes in at $750 for the body only, with the 77D priced at $900, and both will be released in April. So the question is it worth the $150 for those few external features that the 77D has over the T7i?
Yeah, probably.
You think so? The top LCD and a back button focus?
Well, it's got the extra, the dial.
Scroll wheel.
The scroll wheel.
Yeah, there's small things. Personally,
wasn't the body slightly large? No, it's the same body, basically.
It's basically the same body.
Slightly little heavier.
So it'd be T7i, 77D, 80D.
Which makes, I mean, the 80D now it does that all, the IPB, Sorry, the all eye.
Video wise, the 80D all day.
Yeah.
Still wise, I might go the 70-70.
Yeah, I mean, even the T7i as a starter camera is fully loaded. It's locked and it's, loaded.
Yeah, it's stocked for
can,
sure.
Can you give me a click of that? The gun right there. No, can you? It's locked and loaded. Thank you. Locked and loaded.
And I'll make this next one short and sweet. Introducing the M6, which is an M5 without the EVF.
Except they want me to let you know that it's a little thinner and smaller.
Little thinner. It's basically the M3, but upgraded. And the flip-out screen flips up and not down. Well, huh. I think it does still flip down, but it does
no,
flip
it doesn't up. Flip down.
Okay, so it flips up because before the EVF in the M5 is blocking it. So you can't flip it up. That flips down.
Yeah.
So this might be more of a vlogger-type camera, but spec-wise... Everything is exactly the same. This is basically
definitely
a replacement.
Make cameras just for vloggers. That's all the specs we need. We need everything for vloggers.
Yep. Basically, this is a replacement just for the M3. A lot of people thought it was for the M5, but what they were doing is they're changing their naming scheme for the mirrorless lineup to now match their DSLR number lineup. So instead of going up, they're going down.
So confusing.
Like you've got the 7D, then the 5D, then the 1D. Now you're going to have the M5.
We should just make a camera for every letter and number combination in the world.
Yeah. To me, this hints at a full-frame mirrorless camera.
Yeah, probably.
Because then there's going to be the M4, M3, M2, M1. There's got to be a camera in there somewhere that has a full frame. You never know.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Yeah. And then price-wise, this will cost $780, which is about $200 cheaper than the M5. But if you purchase their optional EVF, that will run you more than the cost of the M5 with the built-in EVF. I think that's $250.
Yeah, so basically the M6 doesn't have a viewfinder. If you want to add a viewfinder, you give them $250. Or you basically go back to before you purchased the M6 and you're like, oh, I'm going to buy the M5 because it has a viewfinder.
Unless you want the M6 with the flip-up screen and the EVF optional.
But I know that...
People might want that. I don't know.
They say that's a little thinner. It's a little svelte, but it's already small enough.
It's tiny.
I rather have a larger grip. A better feeling grip than a thinner grip.
I think the D5600 has a little more of a thick, chunky grip.
Yeah.
I feel like that is a really solid grip.
Girthy.
Chunky,
guys. It's a girthy grip.
Guys, it's a girthy grip.
Girthy. Yeah.
Chunky peanut butter or smooth?
Smooth all day.
It was smooth all day. My brother used to like the chunky. I couldn't eat the chunky. It made me want to throw up.
Yeah.
Really?
I love peanuts now, though. I always love peanuts.
With the M6, I love how everyone was commenting on our M5 review saying, I'll just wait for the M6 to come out. It's going to be better.
Yeah.
Bigger.
There's rumors that an M6 is coming. This is stupid. I'm like,
step down.
Here like, I can't comment on this because I have an NDA, but stop, you know, just
I
because.
I wanted to comment.
My favorite is when people leave comments like
they know
announced the best thing in the world, but all they did was read Canon rumors.
A headline.
And Nikon rumors, which generally get it pretty close.
Yeah.
Generally.
But then everybody's like, the rumors.
I will say, but though, for the 5D Mark IV, I follow that religiously with Canon rumors, and they posted so many different versions of rumored specs, and none of them are right until like the week of the camera announcement.
Sure.
So you just got to wait until...
Yep.
Those sites crush, though.
Grain of salt.
They do.
Those sites crush.
Rumor sites are big. We try not to report on rumors, usually because we know about it.
Yeah. It makes it hard to announce it. So the only way that we could report on rumors, Stephen, is if you had an NDA, I didn't know anything about it, and I could say whatever I want. Or if I had the NDA...
Well, there has been times like that, I think, where you had the NDA and I didn't, and I reported on it. But I feel like we might have cut those segments out of shows.
No, because I'm like, Steven, you can't do that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we've cut parts out because of that. A few more stories. There's a new experimental camera that was created using 30...
Wait, is it called the Relanc?
Not the Relanc. This is a camera made out of 32,000 drinking straws.
Oh, good.
Cleverly called the straw camera.
Oh, how'd they come up with that?
Crazy, man. So unique. It's basically a wooden box.
Does it suck?
Or blow.
It's just got a shit ton of straws crammed into this box. The homemade camera was designed by Michael Farrell and Cliff Haynes and works by simply letting light pass through thousands of 10-inch straws that each serve as an individual, quote-unquote, lens.
Are they bendy straws or regular straws?
That's like the question straws. I had. That's the question I had. Yeah.
And they'll provide the camera with a theoretical f/127 aperture.
Are they clear or are they the dark ones?
Dark ones.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are they plastic or paper? Metal. Are they
green? I think
they're
plastic.
Okay.
I want to say plastic,
so
not recycled.
It's not environment friendly.
Yes.
Now, is it this crazy straw that I used to get at Sesame Place?
Oh, the little circle one?
And it had like Oscar the Grouch, and then I would try to eat it, and it was hard-ass plastic?
Is it a thin straw or a thick straw? Could I use it for a milkshake?
Because
the thin straws probably use that are bad for milkshakes.
It's kind of in between the thick and the thin ones.
Okay. Now, if I was to fold them up like this and have somebody flick it, would it pop?
Probably.
I did that to an old person the other day, and by old, I mean like 47. And they shied away. They're like, what is this? Is it going to hurt me? I'm like, you've never flicked a freaking thing before? And I did it. Steven, I actually held onto it with one hand and flicked it myself, and it worked.
Huh.
That was a really good one.
It's amazing. Congratulations.
Yeah, man. Balls. That's what gets me excited these days.
So anyway, all these straws put together, the light then hits photosensitive paper behind them and exposes it, similar to like a pinhole setup.
And
however,
it doesn't work.
One of the creators says there is very little in common between the pinhole camera and a straw camera. The pinhole gives an entire image from a single point perspective, where the straw camera produces a multi-point perspective from an array.
I mean, that's cool.
And the resulting images basically looks like what a fly's perspective would be of the world.
That's
like
pretty cool.
Circles everywhere, all right. And like a beehive type look. They also made a second version of the camera made out of black plastic protective floor sheeting instead of straws, since the
they
straws
got nothing
tended,
better to do. Apparently.
The straws, yeah, right. Let's make a straw camera, but they would shift each time, creating like a different type of picture every time they took a picture. Huh. It wouldn't be the same. Like it's almost like the pixel would shift, like as in a straw would shift. But it's cool. It's interesting. I would never use it, but
yeah, of course.
Figured I'd bring
now,
it up.
Can I get it for $99 a month?
Nope.
No,
I don't think they're selling it. I think it's just a project they put together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Can I snort stuff with it?
That you could do. 32,000
times.
Sign
me up.
And then Nikon has officially canceled their DL series, their compact one-inch cameras that were announced last year, I think February of last year, but never made it to market after several delays. Nikon says, in quotes, "Everyone involved has worked very hard to develop products with which our customers will be satisfied. However, it has been decided that sales of the DL series will be canceled due to concerns regarding their profitability, considering the increase in development costs and the drop in the number of expected sales due to the slowdown of the market."
They could have called me on the phone, like Mr. Nikon could have called me on the phone last year and been like, "Jared,
Mr. Nikon,
do you think we should sell this line of cameras?" And I would have been like, "Mr. Nikon, please, Dan, add a phone voice to this, please."
"Mr. Nikon, no."
"Yes."
"No, you should sell these. You should not do. You should cancel this."
"It's not Mr. Nikon. It's Mr. Nikon. Please pronounce my name right."
"All right. Well, your advertising in the United
Nikon.
States says Nikon."
"Well, he's wrong. I don't appreciate it."
"Nikon.
Is that Noah on the phone?
Nikon. No, this is Mr. Nikon." "So Mr. Nikon.
Nikon.
Mr. Nikon, I tell you, cancel the DL line before it even starts."
"Okay.
Thank you. Goodbye."
"Goodbye.
Nikon.
Nikon. Goodbye. Chew. Nikon."
So this was basically their direct response to the RX100 and those one-inch compact camera series, which is a hit among a lot of
but
people.
But it's a hit that's been around for 5 years.
It has been, yes. And it's their fifth generation now. They're on the RX100 Mark V, but they're popular. Maybe they thought that this would also be popular. Obviously it wasn't.
I'm head of the class.
Yeah, I feel like you don't see Ferrari going out and making like a Yugo just because it's hip and cool. Like, it's, you know,
stay in your lane.
Yeah, stay in your lane.
Nikon didn't really have any like heavy duty professional
Nikon's
compact
point
cameras, right?
Their point and shoot cameras have sucked for a long time.
Same with Canons. Canons.
The Canon was bad, but they came out Canon had the G12 and the
G16,
like all of that stuff.
Yeah.
And the G18.
And they had the S100 line.
Like,
that
those
was pretty good.
Those were good. The Canon, when I used to
but
sell.
But I still think using that RX100 Mark IV when we reviewed that was. That blew the Canons away, I think.
That's in Japan right now.
It's also $1,000.
Mine's
so.
In Japan. I gave it to Betty to take to Japan.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, nice.
You think he's actually taking pictures?
No, he's taking pictures, I guarantee you, with his iPhone and posting that. And he's not going to use... I guarantee you he doesn't take any pictures with it.
I
told him. I'm like...
Is that the one we lent to Todd for Disney World?
Yeah, and he took
it to Disney.
You know how many pictures he took?
Take one picture with it.
But I did... When I was looking at the card that Todd left in the camera, he did somehow take pics.
Not somehow. So that was for you.
Images of nothing. He couldn't
basically
see anything.
There was nothing there.
Yeah, just nothing. So the camera giant also announced to shareholders.
Like, I'm not even sure which transgendered bathroom he goes in.
Nikon announced to shareholders the recognition of an extraordinary loss due to restructuring expenses, which they say it was about $260 million.
Yeah.
And 1,000 workers are also being let go via a voluntary retirement plan.
Oh, boo.
And since the announcement, the company's stock then dropped 15% the following day. I know this news was reported like 2 weeks ago, after we recorded
I made the rant.
I wanted to bring it up because it's pretty important.
Not a rant. I put a video out discussing it. You can check that out over on my YouTube. It's there. I'm not going to reiterate it right here.
Sure.
I'll just double down on the fact that extraordinary loss is a term that's used in the financial world, and it basically stands for an unforeseen expenditure, a one-time thing, a major issue that isn't going to it's not supposed to happen again. So it's a one-time thing.
Extraordinary. It's taken literal. Yes, yeah.
Exactly. So that's that.
Yeah. I mean, I think it doesn't translate well in English, but
I Googled it.
And then Instagram is now also doing that full album thing we were talking about 2 weeks ago on Last
RawTalk. Let's put 10 images and videos into a feed. Now, I just updated mine. It didn't let me do it yet. So I guess it will be rolling out.
Sure.
Because up in the live thing, there's a demo on how to do it, but it hasn't rolled out to me yet.
So basically lets you tell your story. I think it'll be good because there are so many times, like the helicopter thing in Vegas, where I want to post 6-7 pictures in a row, but I don't want to post them all in one day and blow up someone's feed.
Yeah.
But I also don't want to wait a week to post them all.
But I also don't want to just post one with 10 images when I could spread it out across 10 days.
It's true.
And maybe or 10 images and people would see it.
Yeah. Yeah. We're going to have to test it out.
Now, unless their algorithm at the beginning gives you more reach with.
True.
That.
Yeah.
Maybe they'll
in the beginning they'll boost it. Yeah.
So
it is Facebook.
Basically.
After all.
That's
it for photo news.
That's it for photo news.
I got through it.
So is it time to get to the gears of the week?
I think it is time for gears of the week. But gear, right?
Not gear. Plural. Well, yeah, gear. Don't trip over anything this time.
Dan will be bringing gear of the week in.
Ooh.
Do you have to plug into it?
I do.
So I'll talk about this.
This will take a minute.
While you're plugging in. This is a teleprompter from a company called Prompter People. We are doing a review on it, but I did buy it. This setup was $2,400 to get this prompter, not the tripod. We need to get a bigger, better tripod for it to do it. But this is a 24-inch widescreen monitor TV. It's like a TV.
It's big.
And then a big ass mirror for your teleprompter part, and then you can shoot through it. Now, you can go to Prompter People's website, you can look it up, you can see they have a special type of glass that makes it brighter and easier to read. The reason we got a 24-inch one is because I was tired of using that little 9.6-inch one that I had that was a pain in the ass. So small. I'm blind. I need bigger. In this case, I'm like, these people, I'm going to use their prompter. And so I talked to them. We bought it. We're going to review it. We've used it already. It means that you could go up to like 50 feet away and still read this damn thing. Steven's going to get it set up right now so that Todd could test it out and read something.
It's impressive how far away you can read it.
I can make the letters super large, and you can't tell I'm reading. My eyes do shift like this. That doesn't mean I'm reading. That just means my eyes are shifting like that.
Todd, can you see this?
I can see it. Yeah.
Can we do a test with you real quick?
Sure. Yeah.
All right.
I can see a hole in the middle where the camera's supposed to be.
It's playing. You ready?
Read it.
So what's your story? No, seriously, what's your story? Because that's why you bought the camera, right? And the lenses, and the lights, and the microphone, or the beat machine, or the script writing program, or the guitar, or even that painted canvas you got in the back room. You wanted to tell your story, right? The problem is that so many of us, it's really fast. And your story is the most important part of your production. So tell your story and tell it the best way you can. Remember, everything else is like just like a tool, just like Jared. I am not Ron Burgundy. That was a little fast, but I mean,
we can. You can finesse
and dude,
the
I'm
speed.
Telling you what, you could probably back that up another
notch or two,
another couple yards, and I could still see that.
Well, and that was just small font. Is that going to pick up in the camera at all? Was
it
anybody going to see that?
Yeah, it probably, center. Yeah, they should be able to see it in that middle angle.
Oh,
right
I forgot there's the middle angle.
Yeah, we tested it out. So
This is the 24-inch one. They also have a more affordable option, I believe is $700 for one that uses the iPad Pro. We have that over in the corner set up, but this is something like Todd could have at home and put a script in so he doesn't have to film it four times. If he writes a script, he could then perform it.
I generally do write a script, but I think if you do a lot of corporate work, this is a no-brainer. Because when you get the people in front of camera that need to say something specific and they're not used to being on camera,
oh yeah,
This is a lifesaver. It makes him look like a rock star.
Or they try to ad lib.
Well, and I will say like, the only like Steve. Issue we had, I don't know if you guys already said this, but if you are that close within, say, 10 feet and you use the full 24-inch wide screen, you can almost see your eyes going left to right.
Yeah.
Ended up doing is making it pretty much 4:3 aspect ratio, and we gaff taped black bars, so it was just the center portion that we were using.
Yeah.
Now, if we were 30 feet back, your eye movement wouldn't be noticeable.
Yeah, bigger isn't always better. Exactly. It depends if you need it to be far away.
Yeah.
That's great. Or if it's a vision thing, then that's...
Yeah, for Jared, his eyes already shaped.
You got to weigh
so
your options.
You can't even tell.
Yeah.
For me, it was so much easier. My eyes still gave me trouble.
They still stress, yeah.
But it was still so much easier to read because it was larger.
Yeah.
And that's why we picked this up.
I think when your eyes focus on something for a long time, they really start to...
They start shaking.
Freak out, yeah.
Yep, they get tired and they start shaking. Yeah. All right, so that's gear of the week. Prompter people, you can go look at their stuff.
It's great.
Not the least expensive stuff in the world, but...
Best of the best.
But it's definitely quality.
Yeah, definitely worth it.
Oh, and it comes with the software called FlipQ, plugs in with a USB drive.
Little dongle, and you just...
It automatically reverses everything, so you don't have to do that, which we had to get a separate app for this. I don't know what they offer for the iPad.
I pretty much just set that up in, 20 seconds?
Yep. Oh, yeah.
We already had a script that I saved beforehand, but...
Best script ever.
Pop in the USB, play the software, and you're set.
That's Gear of the Week. Let's get to Flying Solo, where you guys submit your questions, and I give my answers. And so do you guys, too, on occasion. We've got some video questions, we got some regular questions. Bob Massilo... Looking for a recommendation on a fast lens for my Canon 7D. Oh, geez, it's just a 7D. I hope it's a Mark II. To photograph my grandson's high school wrestling matches in a fairly bright gym. Yeah, it really does say in a fairly bright gym.
The 7D to photograph a lot of college basketball games back in the day, but I also was shooting with the 7200-28.
The right answer to this is, what is the lens I recommend? It's a 70-200 2.8.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
Whether it's a Tamron, a Sigma, or a Canon version 1 that you got refurbed or used.
It's almost a 10-year-old camera now.
Yeah, when I was at Alan's camera the other week, there was a Fro reader that came in, and he was looking between a Nikon 80-200 2.8 ED, which is much slower focusing because it came out in the 90s. I own that lens. It was a great lens. Or the Sigma used was like $150 more for a 70-200 2.8 OS. I'm like, if I were you, I would go with the faster focusing one. You're not really going to be able to tell the difference between the quality of both. Yeah. They're both good, but for what you're doing, if you can squeeze out a couple extra bucks, I would recommend the 70-200. So I'd go 70-200 all day.
I have a question for you.
Yeah, did you submit it?
No. But my question is, why do you always refer to them as Fro readers? Because for the most part, they're
watchers.
Probably not reading.
I'm a Fro watcher. I'm a Fro watcher.
That's all I got. That's my question.
I don't know. That's a good question, too, because I've always wondered it myself. I just call them Fro readers because they follow. Fro followers, something like that.
Yeah, I
Fro
mean, I follower. Guess they are more of a viewer.
Fro fans.
Fro viewer.
I mean, yeah, they're viewers.
I mean, that's a stretch. Fans, that's a stretch.
Whatever, Todd. I mean, here's a fan for you.
Ooh.
First question.
You blew that.
We have a video question from Jeremiah A. Mulford.
Is he on Rumsinger?
Hey, Fro and everybody at the Fro Factory. It's Jeremiah from Indiana.
I'm going to pause. Way to be excited, Jeremiah. It's Jeremiah from Indiana. Come on! I'm just kidding.
He went to the Jared Polin School of Video.
I have a Nikon D5500, and I've been using my 17-50 f2.8 from Sigma for my indoor photography stuff. And I'm debating between going to a 70-200 f2.8... or if I should look at the Sigma 50-100 f1.8. I would appreciate any suggestions or thoughts on it. Like I said, it's for indoor photography, so please let me know. Thanks.
So the first suggestion I have is watch your damn headroom.
Thanks, Jeremiah.
That's a good question, Jeremiah. We're not really making fun of you.
It's a recurring joke with the
headroom that people leave so much headroom. But that's perfectly fine. Thank you for submitting a video question and having the... I can't say having the balls to do that. No, because women are going to, again, upset at me and say, but vaginas are strong.
Just digging that hole, man.
Well, tell them thanks for having a big vagina and doing it. So excited.
Thank you for having the gumption to do it.
The gumption. Sure.
Because balls are weak, as people women have reminded me.
You can thank him for the energy that he put into
thank
that.
You for exuding the Thank you for having the guts.
Thank you for being as obnoxious as Jerry.
Yeah, but guts, Stephen, guts are, I don't know. Okay, yes, thank you. Good question. So, indoor photography, 70 to 200, 2.8 versus a 50 to 100 f1.8 on a Sigma side. That is such a small, not versatile range that maybe for video, 50 to 100 is cool, which we should test out, as you suggested.
Yeah.
But I think for me, indoor photography, depending on what it is, I mean, the majority of it is a 70 to 200 all day long if you have room. I'm going to stick with that. I'm going to stick with that.
Sure.
Dennis Geist von Lechtenberg. Oh, nice. Do you have tips for somebody who wants to do more street photography but is often shy to casually shoot strangers? Yeah, get over it.
And look both ways on the street.
Well, look.
Yeah, that's
you
tough.
Have to just do it. You have to grab life by the horns.
As the famous Shia LaBeouf said,
just do it!
Just do it!
Do it!
Do it!
Do it!
So random.
Just do it! Just do it!
Why the green screen?
I have no idea.
It was great. I loved him in Holes.
There's some people you just can't figure out, so don't
even Steven. Did you like Even Stevens as a kid?
Yeah, solid.
If I recall, his sister was hot. I don't remember. I'm just making that up. Look, strangers. Yeah, no. You just have to go do it.
Just do it.
The best way to do it is to do the exact thing that scares you and walk up to the first person and say something. Then walk up to the second person and say something. And do it 500 times.
So you get more comfortable.
Maybe even hold up a sign on a street corner that doesn't say free hugs, but say, hi. Literally hold a sign that says, I am shy. Not Shia LaBeouf. That's funny. I am shy. I have to say hi to 1,000 people, so please say hi or let me say hi to you. I actually think that's a pretty good idea.
Or
I think
just have free photos on your shirt.
No.
Start taking pictures.
No.
Fine.
Just say hi. Barb, shut the fuck up!
Oh my God. That's like a little kid outside, not Barb.
Oh, it is? It wasn't Barb?
No.
Hello, Jared. Stop yelling at my grandson. He's trying to just make a living out here on the corner.
Slinging rocks.
I have him slinging rocks since he's been 7. He's currently 9, so please don't yell at him.
You know,
goodbye.
Do you know the security cameras show a very interesting guy waddling up to them right now? Kind of, he may be looking for gluten.
That's weird. It's funny how that happens.
Yeah, so no, I would just do the strangers and wave to people. Say hi. I think that's actually a pretty good idea.
I mean, just got to talk to people.
You just got to talk to
people.
It's
the hardest thing, but just got
to
do it.
It's like Steven trying to get his girlfriend.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Next question comes from Jocelyn Proud.
Hey, Fro. Following a photo exhibition, I'm now stuck with 15 canvas print that cost me more than $1,000 Canadian. I tried Facebook, Kijiji, and even eBay. I'm having a hard time getting my money back. I just had a request for a new exhibition with another series of photos, and I hesitated because I feel I will lose more money. What is the best way to sell your prints according to you, and how to price them right? Thank you.
All right, so that's a great question, and I've spoken about this in the past about exhibits and spending a shit ton of money on framing and getting your work done that's most likely not going to sell. An exhibit is it's great, and congratulations on getting asked to exhibit stuff. Best recommendation I have for something like this is probably order basic prints from an Adorama Pix that are posters and magnetize them to the wall. Or leave yourself a white border and tape them to the wall. And if somebody wants to buy it, then you do it to buy to order a canvas or something like that. So you're not spending $1,000 on the exhibit. And, well, sorry, $1,000 Canadian is like $800 US or $790. Exhibits are difficult to sell your stuff at because usually it's your family and friends coming out to see it and they're like, well, am I going to pay $500 for this?
Yeah.
Or are you going to sell it for cost? At this point, you make a poster print that maybe costs you $6, $7, $8 for a nice size one and do that 10 times and spend $100 Canadian, a couple of loonies and a couple of toonies, and you'll be better off because you're not spending as much, and then you will make to order and ship it to them. That's my answer.
Sure.
Next question. Kyle Markham.
What up, Jared and the gang? Kyle and Markham here from Markham Motion Pictures. And I got a question. So I'm releasing my first YouTube video on my channel this Wednesday. And I need to know, when do I start thinking about merchandising and sponsors? Do I wait until I have a couple thousand subscribers? Or do I start doing that immediately and get them at the ground level? Okay, guys. Really would love to hear your insights. And you guys have a great rest of your day.
All right, Kyle.
What up, Kyle?
Thank you, Kyle. Good question.
Hey, Kyle.
Good use of headroom. Good use of headroom because he did it horizontally. Most other people do it vertically, which I have no problem with vertical. Anyway.
Todd loves vertical video.
So he's putting out a video, his first YouTube video on Wednesday.
Okay.
Should he monetize now or worry about sponsors, worry about advertising?
He should be monetizing, selling merch, getting hiring sponsors.
People already.
He should already have a meetup scheduled.
Probably buy a
as well. For his three subscribers,
definitely.
He should have a meetup at the Starbucks behind the dumpster.
So nobody, Kyle, the truth of the matter is, you're not even supposed to think about this at this point.
No. I mean, he's probably going to get it.
You may
views
get 12 views on it, and those 12 views
are
you
and family.
Are you logging on to see how many views you have?
Refresh.
How do you think Todd's daughter has 3,500 views on the video? Todd just keeps playing it.
That's my wife.
No, that's me disliking it over and over again.
I will fight you.
I know. I went to her last video, and I'm like, it has no dislikes.
Oh, well, today it will.
But I gotta
what's your channel, Todd?
YouTube.com/MorganJean.
And let me get back to Kyle in a second, but what good has come out of this so far by making those videos?
Yeah, breaking news. She booked a gig because of YouTube.
Woo!
Yeah, no, her agency called and was like, yeah, could you shoot a little, 30-second video of her just saying anything? It could be on her phone.
Oh, my God, Dada.
Cool. And I was like, my wife called me. I was like, there's no way I'm shooting it on my phone. Send them to YouTube.
Send them the link.
Bust out my 5D4. Check out my production value.
So basically,
Cheesesteak Media.
But she booked it, and it's for Camelback,
Camelback
Water
Mountain
Park,
water
which
park
is in the Poconos, man. big water park in the Poconos.
I've been there.
In Pennsylvania.
Did they find her out just by browsing YouTube, or how did they actually?
No, her agency. Her agency asked about it.
But
then, of course, her agency person was like, so who does the videos? Would they be willing to, hook us up? And I was like, no. I told my wife, I'm like, no.
Always.
No. Let's not go down that road.
It's like, how are you an agency in this day and age and don't have an on-staff video person, editor?
You could make a mint at an agency doing that sort of thing.
Gary Vaynerchuk. I mean, that's exactly why Gary,
still waiting on that phone call.
Let me plug Gary here. They're looking for a D-Rock. It's like, are you D-Rock or something? It's Vayner.
Oh, that's Gary right now.
Hey, Gary, I got to call you back. No. Listen, no, he's right here. No, just I got to call. Yes, I'm crushing. But no, I got to call you back. All right, goodbye.
Sorry, guys.
Send that text. I'll call later, Gary.
Hey.
Oh, my bad.
Anyway, let me just interrupt Kyle and all this other stuff. Gary's looking for more people like his guy called D-Rock and Tyler Babin. These are guys that go around with Gary and video his and take photos of the day in his life, and then they edit it and they put out that package. So what they're looking for, because Gary has an agency, and they are looking to do this for more people, and they're selling that, not selling, but they're making the packages, and they're looking for people that can do this. So they put out the call that if you're in wherever you're at, if you're in New York, it doesn't matter, but primarily in New York would be better. If you have the gumption to put yourself out there and you're a full-time, you're a creative that can shoot, edit, do audio, do video, do all of this different stuff. If you can deliver this, if this is you, then they have a job for you. Doesn't matter how many people apply for this. If you're right for the job, they're going to test you out. Do it. Try it. It's go to Gary V's channel. He'll talk about it. I think it's Gary V, G-A-R-Y-V-E-E.
GaryV.com/RUDrock. Don't ask how I know that, but that's what it is.
And so, Kyle, so the answer to your question, the well-rounded answer, is no. You should not be worrying about monetizing, turning ads on, because most likely you're going to have 12 people watching. And if you have more than that, that's awesome. This is a long game. Sponsors aren't going to show up because you have 300 subscribers. Probably not going to show up. Well, even if you had 3,000, then you could start thinking about it. Then you could start thinking about when you have interactions.
I should start thinking about it.
And unlike... Yeah, all right, that's it. Next question.
We wish him luck, though. Don't get us wrong.
Yeah.
Definitely best of luck.
Crush it.
Hashtag Chris crush it.
Ball Frizzle.
Ball Frizzle.
B-A-L-F-R-I-Z-Z-L-E.
Ball Frizzle?
Yeah. Chris Ball Frizzle. I am currently using Lightroom and Photoshop for post, but keep hearing very good things about Capture One Pro. Have you had any experience with it? And if so, what are your thoughts? So, not a lot of experience. This is what Richie brought to us?
Yeah. Capture One Pro 10.
It seems like Capture One has a lot of subtle tweaks and controls and gives you more power.
More like sharpness control and
a lot. It seems to give you more individual control than Lightroom. Now, organizationally, it doesn't give you any control. Yeah. So you have no organizational capabilities.
It's not like catalogs with Lightroom.
But the individual controls that you have for tweaking are pretty good.
Very fine-tuned.
So that's the answer on that.
And they say the processing of your RAW file is better than Lightroom's processing.
Yeah.
Your profile.
All right. Next question. Opening that up. It is from Jake Snyder.
Hey, Fro. How's it going? So my question to you is, as you go through people's websites and other places, you bust on them for calling themselves a professional photographer, an amateur photographer, saying you're a photographer. Photographer is a photographer. However, in all these My Gear Vault videos, your name tag on the bottom says Jared Polin, professional photographer. Not trying to bust on you or call you a hypocrite. I'm just curious as to why the change, if, you know, what deemed that necessary. Love all you do. Keep it up. Have a good one.
Well, the
Bravo. The answer
to that is I don't recall ever being asked what should go under my name on my gear vault.
We had that discussion, and you said professional photographer.
Did I?
Yes. Me, you, and Steve.
What was the discussion about?
What it should say on the lower third.
It probably went like this. Jared, what do you think we should put in the lower third? Professional photographer, of course.
What do you think? Like,
we went back and forth, too, with My Gear Vault, the app developers, Tomas and a bunch of other people, and they ended up actually making the final lower third, which then we mimicked basically on our end and put it in.
That's because we were also basing it on the simple fact that a lot of people might not know
who's viewing
who
this.
You are. Yeah. Like,
what's
why should I trust what you are saying?
Yeah.
So, right. You know,
for the insurance
expert,
part,
professional photographer.
Fro readers might be familiar with you and who you are and the fact that you don't use that tag, but, you know, other non-Fro readers...
Right. I don't think you brought it up, saying that's what you want it specifically called, but I do remember
it was a question we had, and I know we discussed it with you.
So I think in that in the context when we were discussing it, it's more so the fact that
it's a broader audience,
it's insurance, and it was building credibility in that sense, not building up my photo work, but building up credibility in the fact that I know
not
what I'm talking about.
Yeah, not stroking your ego like we normally do. But this is like this actually was for a reason.
It's a good question, and it does beg the question of on your website saying amateur is not good, and do you need to say professional on your business card or just photographer because your work speaks for itself? So I guess that's the reason why it says professional photographer is credibility on in that case.
Sure. Yeah, because not everyone will know who you are when they watch these videos, so you gotta just make it easy and professional photographer, and then they get a sense of what you do and who you are.
But good question.
Yeah, best question.
Ever.
Dicks. And I don't mean you. Kieran Judd, when you go to photo shoot, do you clean your lenses and sensors the day before you go on a shoot?
Ooh.
So,
that's a good question.
I don't ever clean my sensor, to be honest with you. Mm. The one time I tried cleaning my sensor back with a D3 back in the day, it ended up, I used this bullshit spinning brush thing that
you spin the brush for the static
and then you do the wipey thing, and all I did was just smudge oil like completely across the sensor.
I never physically cleaned it myself that, but I have just done the internal cleaning sensor.
Yes, I do
mode.
The internal cleaning. Lenses, on the other hand, Steven cleans those all the time.
Jared is the worst with cleaning his lenses.
I used
clean
to
them every time we shoot.
Well, I used to do that. I used to do a better, like,
yeah,
most of the, they're not going to interfere with your images, but
I clean mine every single time, front and back element.
And I don't use filters.
I lick both of mine every time I use them.
Yeah, I don't use filters. So if I'm going to have it cleaned, I'm most likely taking it to a professional. I know Richie does it all the time before shoots.
Richie's super anal about that stuff, though, yeah. So I'm sure he's good at it.
That's a skill. Yeah, I wouldn't dive into that lightly.
Yeah,
I just take it to Alan's camera, Alan's a Palooza, or Canon a Palooza, or Canon Ball. And when they do the cleaning and have them do it.
When we went to Canon Expo, I believe that's when I got my 5D
yes,
Mark
did
III
that
clean finally, because when we shot the Sigma review, somehow my sensor must have been exposed and sand got in it or something.
Oh, yeah. My Mark III, I just had its sensor cleaned. I got it done at the Cannonball.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Next question is a video question from Lord. Lord Helmet.
Hi, Jared. This is Lord from Italy. I know that you guys use the MiFoto tripods, but could you recommend a good durable tripod that isn't too heavy and that will last me quite a few years? Thanks a lot. Keep up the good work. I listen every week, but unfortunately I cannot watch the show like I used to every week. Bye.
Dan, who's paying us to talk about their tripods this week? No, nobody's paying us to talk about tripods. For what you're looking for, the MiFotos...
He's talking about still photography, right? Or video?
We'll just go with still photography, okay. Is I believe what he's talking about. These MiFotos are little dinky, expensive as hell.
For what they are, they are expensive.
For carbon fiber that we've taken them around the world
we
so far. They're fine. They're not... They wouldn't be my choice of a tripod for photos if I needed one.
I hate the ball head on it, but
yeah, they're fine.
They do the job.
Whatever. They're not a, nobody, whether a sponsor is a sponsor, the best thing to do is you are going to spend between $500 and $600 for a quality pair of sticks and a quality head. I remember buying my 055 MF4 from Manfrotto 067? When I worked at Allen's.
What?
No, it was 055
934
MF4.
Oh, 069.
No.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And that the 055 MF4 meant
007.
Four expansions of the legs. They were carbon fiber. And then I got one of these heads, a grippy head, and that's what I like shooting with. So Manfrotto makes very good ones as well. Gitzo is a higher end Manfrotto. They're extremely expensive. Some of these Ben Rose are very nice on the higher end. We've used Vanguards in the past, but I don't think Vanguard actually sells a higher end tripod that I would recommend that you're going to have for a super long time.
Yeah, I've personally used a lot of the Vanguards here. They're good for what they do for us, but I do wish they had a little bit of a higher end model for that like professional still photographer.
So for you, I mean, the carbon fiber ones are more expensive. They're lighter, but get a more substantial one that's taller, that has some girth to it, and you're going to spend some money. But the great thing about tripods is you spend the money now, and 15, 20 years down the road,
still
you still have
still
this. Yep. And with the Manfrotto ones, I have a broken clip. I know I could contact them, and they're going to replace the clip. The clip got broken under an airplane. So
you like the pistol grip too, right?
I hate the unscrew this. Unscrew this, unscrew the three.
Yeah,
step
well,
ones.
That's what the MiFotos have, which I'm not a huge fan of because I don't feel like they're
sort
that
of.
Pinpoint
they're the ball head
accurate.
Yeah, I like a grip.
Can be a little iffy though too.
It's slower and it's not as accurate
like
because
fine tuned.
It's harder to fine tune. That's what I would say about tripods. Next up, we have something from Terry Peter.
What's up, Fro Nation? I don't have a question for you. I just wanted to say thank you guys for all the content that you guys put out. I really appreciate it. Me and my wife made the spin that wheel noise that you guys are currently using. I hope you enjoy it. Once again, thank you guys. Peace.
All right, Terry. Well, thank you very much for sending that in. Todd, go ahead and let that roll.
Spin that wheel.
Beautiful.
That is a good spin that wheel.
Is it?
That was
pretty
one of the
good.
Best ones.
It's
yeah,
pretty
that's
good.
The one we use every week.
Yeah.
Oh, the spin.
Yeah.
That.
They did that.
Well, yeah.
The couple.
The nice. One that just played that I heard.
The one you just played that
exactly.
you heard.
Exactly. The one
that
I
great.
Just pushed the button and it played
it.
Simultaneously
clearly.
As I pushed the button.
Yeah, Dan didn't put it in
not
post
done
anything.
In post.
No.
It just happened. Watch, I'm going to do it again.
That one.
That one.
Yeah.
See?
We're long.
Sounds great.
Bobby Hayden. I own a Nikon 24-70 2.8 and the 70-200 2.8 with a Nikon D7D200. I've listened and invested in glass. I want to go full frame. I shoot mostly sports and some portraits. The D750 looks like the camera I want, but a little outdated. Should I stay with crop and get the D500? I don't understand people and their 24 to 70s on a cropped camera. The 24 to 70 doesn't give you the wide angle.
Yeah.
So I the D750 is a little older right now and probably will be replaced.
It still holds up though.
It's a fantastic body. Their screen is a little flimsier compared to what they did with the D500. Yeah. If you can get a D750 for a good value, but you have a D7200, stick with that for a little longer. I don't even know why. That's a good body unto itself. The 7200 is the most recent one.
Yeah.
I don't go to a D500 from a D750. I know you shoot mostly sports and lands and some portraits, but right now, hold off.
And I do think technology has finally almost caught up with cameras, where there's not really substantial upgrades being made every 2-3 years, where before it'd be huge updates. You know, that camera was way too old at that point. Now I feel like the D750 still holds strong today, 4 years late, 3 years, whatever it is,
it's a couple
later.
Years.
And the 5D Mark III. All those cameras, D810.
Mike Bozio. Hi, guys. This question is for Jared, Steven, and not really for Mr. 12,800. I'm kind of new to photography, like I'm sure many of this page... Really? You typed like? Like, sometimes I miss so many shots because I'm trying so hard, and I keep going between modes. I don't know if you should choose one over the other so you can shoot and get a sharp image. Thanks for all you guys do. I personally am primarily going to be in... Manual.
Me too.
But I will tell you that I lived in aperture priority.
Or shutter priority. I mean, either or, but...
I think it's more important that you control... For me, it was just easier to control the shutter speed than worry about setting control the aperture than it was to set the shutter speed. I lived in aperture priority more often than anything because I wanted to control the aperture.
Yeah.
I didn't want to set it to 1/1000th of a second and have it be at f8. I wanted more control on the other thing.
Mm-hmm.
Until I finally realized that I could control everything and get better results. So if you need to walk around with one mode to get better, it's aperture priority.
Yeah, I agree.
Wayne, yeah, Todd, nothing for you. Wayne Gammon. Making the jump from DX to FX, I have really grown as a photographer and shoot with the D3200 and love it. I feel that I am ready for more features that would really improve my photos. It seems that the DA10 has caught my eye. I love the features. I am just worried that switching to FX after years of DX may not be all that I hoped for. It's still photography. You shoot photos, whether it's DX or FX or your cell phone, it doesn't matter. A photo is a photo, and what you see is what you get, and that's all that matters. The only thing you have to get used to is you don't get more bang for your buck, theoretically, so your 200 millimeter doesn't become a 300 millimeter 2.8. You have to worry about that.
That definitely took me a while to get used to.
And right. The other thing that it says here, feel that I am ready for more features. There's no different features in the D3200 than in the D810. When you start to get into the pro bodies, it's not about features. It's about manual, aperture, shutter speed, ISO, and yes, you can get faster focusing and shoot more frames a second, but there's not 8 trillion more options to set. There's actually less.
Yeah, a lot of the fancy options I rarely use.
Exactly.
I mean, it's your basic exposure triangle settings that you're using most of the time.
Rob Sella, I'm looking to upgrade from a Canon T3i and wanted... It says, wanted to would you might suggest under $1,100, mostly shoot portraits and concert photography. If you are coming from the Canon world, I don't think there's a worse answer than a T7i or a T77D or a 77D. Either one of those two is going to do a great job for you. If you want to say $1,100 and you want to get some glass, I would go T7i. I mean, how can you go wrong with a T7i right now?
Yeah, like
we're
going
to have to do a really good real-world review for that.
That Rebel is the first that I was actually impressed with.
Yeah.
Spec-wise.
That's flying solo, bro.
Cool.
The last question was, when is my Gear Vault coming out for Android? I think I answered
that
already.
You did answer that.
4 months.
Oh, there's another one there, too. It says, what's your story?
Oh, yeah. You wrote jokes. Oh, you guys. So it's time for the wheel. Dan, where are you going?
Thank you, Dan.
See, I like it. No talking. Don't look me in the eye. That's exactly how a lackey should be.
Okay, on the wheel. So this is the wheel further away than me?
It's a little bit further, yeah.
Is that because Dan didn't put it in the right spot?
Well, I told him to line it up with that, so it's kind of my fault. But
where's the tape that used to be there?
I peeled it up because we moved the table a little more today.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
See, I don't care anymore.
I basically move it a little more and more each week until I'm really at that point where I like it. But yeah. Every week, I feel like it should be a little more turned.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
all right.
So hopefully this week we have it set right.
Look, I just come in and do my job, Steven.
I know.
Which is great. On the wheel, we've got Kessler Crane. Go to kesslercrane.com/fro. Use the code FRO at checkout to get 10% off your order. Spin again. Canon Prize is a nice printer, of which I don't know what printer it would be. If it lands on it, we'll let you know. Then you've got adoramapics.com. That's where I got that metal print and that metal print behind
nice.
Todd.
And the mini ones.
I had the mini ones made for my desk. For shooting video, I'm better off with the matte than the glossy.
Of course.
Because it shows up more contrasty on camera. So that I got both just to test
and
it out.
And those built-in stands, they come with it, right?
Yeah,
as
well,
an option?
I picked that. You could pick a magnet.
That's
you
cool.
could pick a wall hanger. I picked the built-in stand. All my recommendation would be is don't sit there and bend it and unbend it and bend it and unbend it and bend
it's
it and unbend it.
Because
I bet you after about three or four times, it's breaking.
Yeah.
But it's a free option.
Cool.
Next up on the wheel, somebody new. I tried to get a larger logo, but that's what they sent me. It says lensmugshop.com. You have a lens mug. I have lens mug.
Mine.
They also have shot glasses.
Ooh.
If the shot glasses are really just for candy.
Apparently so. Yeah, yeah. I'm going to put some Mars bars in it.
Candy.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, if you want to get some lens mug stuff, go to lensmugshop.com. The code is FROCODE. Dan, that is capital F-R-O. Then there's a space code. It gives you 10% savings to you, FRO followers. It gives that to me when you do that. You like that? Well, I was just reading what was on the teleprompter. On the prompter people
yep.
teleprompter.
I saw you try to think what you put out. You're like, ah.
That's good, right? That was good, Steven. All right, moving on to the wheel. We've got Think Tank photos. We use those each and every week. And now
ooh,
we've got a hole.
A what? Blank space.
There's a blank space because
Taylor Swift
is here.
What?
No, she's not.
Right.
I asked Jeff. I'm like, Jeff, what do I need to print for the wheel? And he's like, just those two things. And then I came and I'm like, wait, no, there's one more thing I wanted to put on the wheel. And it's this.
Didn't we just talk about this last night of what needed to be on the wheel?
Yeah, but this wasn't one of the things.
No, we didn't talk about this?
No. This is gaffer tape from Gaffer Power. Get 40% off when you use the discount code at code gafferpower.com/40.
Or Gaffer Power.
That's awesome. Try the code FRO.
40%.
40% off. So I'm just going to use their gaff tape to tape it to the wheel.
And while you're doing that, I will say I like that gaff tape way more than the stuff you got before, whatever brand that was, because that's more of like a matte
type
of gaff tape, where the one he had before is like vinyl,
and
it just kind of rips off easy. That stuff's nice.
Nice.
Oh, it looks so good.
And there you go.
You should be proud of that.
Can great you job. See what it says?
Not at all.
Not at all.
Maybe we'll just leave
it
there.
I just see bright yellow tape.
Maybe we'll just leave it there forever. Next on the wheel, store.froknowsphoto.com. Go there right now. There's a new store.
I had no idea.
Yeah, I didn't either.
Like, I feel like you didn't tell us at all that you were redoing your store.
Well, I didn't read. Yeah, the store's done. It's now built on Shopify.
That's good.
There's probably a code available for something off, but I'll be announcing that on the email list when I announce the new store is up there.
Code, will they see that on the screen when this comes
out? No, probably not. But if you try code new store, that may be it.
Just try codes.
No, the code new store may be it for 11% off.
Hmm.
I don't want to do 10.
Sure.
I don't
sure.
like round numbers.
We already understand that.
Okay. Store.froknowsphoto.com. Buy that stuff. Rode microphones. Each and every week we use Rode microphones. This is the one we use. Over there you've got Lexar memory cards. We got the Lexar cards that we use as well as the hub. And then we have something else new on the wheel.
Whoa. Ooh.
What is it? Atmosphere aerosol.
Don't spray it in my face this time. Spray it that way.
I can't even see the wheel now.
Oh my God.
It's like when the skyscrapers disappear downtown.
It's so foggy.
Atmosphere aerosol. You can go to Atmosphere Aerosol's website and you can get 10% off with the code FRO. Not FRO code like lens mug shop, just FRO.
Is that capital?
I don't know. It says all capital.
I want one of those for my toys. I need one of those for my toys.
No, you're not getting one.
I need an aerosol
for my
toys.
We've got like 20 cans in the other room.
And I need it here, though.
Next up is Hoya.
Hoya!
Then we've got squarespace.com/fro to get your 14-day trial. Go to squarespace.com/fro to check that out. Rewinding one, we've got all the video guides. Go to froknowsphoto.com/guides to get access to all of that stuff. Now, if you want a free one right now, go to froknowsphoto.com/11days to sign up for the free 11 Days to Better Photography course. Don't buy the video guide or editing guide.
Anything with Todd Wolf in it.
I'm just kidding. You buy those. Todd does that because he doesn't want to pick it up because he's a lazy son of a bitch.
I really don't
want to
pick up all this stuff.
Let me keep going. Videoblocks.com/go/fro. Then we've got the Think Tank bag, my Fronos Photo I Shoot Raw version. You can get that at store.fronosphotorightnow.com. Store.fronosphoto.com. And you can go ahead and... Oh, yeah, that. Then you can probably get 11% off the bag, too, if that code... New store is working.
Oh, that's good.
And Rode microphone once again, and now it's time to spin the wheel.
Yeah, let's do it.
I want you to see the wheel.
Spin! Where'd it go?
Where'd it go?
Oh my goodness.
Where's Jared?
Is the smoke spinning? Around and round it goes. Where it stops, only nobody knows. Where's it going to stop?
My goodness, it's a long one.
Bag.
Son
bag,
of a mother humper dumper.
Oh!
Yes! 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 Yes!
Yes! Dude, it's because you do the same spin.
Steven,
every
how
time.
Is it the same spin? It started on Kessler Crane.
It's weird.
It's Kessler Crane.
You do like, oh,
that's this is the greatest two episodes.
We didn't get it for
ever.
A whole year, and now we got like three and three episodes.
Thank you.
The best.
So that's gonna go to. Let me get the person's name. Congratulations to Jake Snyder. You're
you get a bag.
The winner. You get a bag. Now everybody go a buy bag. A bag at store.fronosphoto.com. Yay.
That make mountain's getting loss. Just a little smaller every week.
Moving on, let's get to memes. Here we are where it's memes, where you can send your memes to the great email address of singwheelofro@gmail.com. The first one is?
Well, I will say we actually got singers this week, but the first
what?
One is... Alexandra Coate. This is Frogan Ball Z. Hey, Frogetta, what does the scouter read? Boop, beep, boop, beep, 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 beep. Out of focus, 12,800.
Oh, I can't even see this.
It's over 9,000. Impossible. Crushed it.
Oh, I'm out of focus, too, in the background.
Don't worry, Nakamel. I'll revive you with the Frogan Balls. Balls.
Wait, is that Noah?
I think so. All I'll say about this one is, nerd!
All right, next.
Next one's from Daniel Siegel. This one's called Android. Meanwhile, Android user's dream.
So is it just a screen grab?
I guess, yeah. My gear vault.
That's funny.
On an Android.
Wait.
One day.
Wait a second. That's Adam Lerner. That's got to be his background. That looks like Adam's...
Is it?
...apartment. I think maybe Adam
looks
made
like
a video.
It looks like it's Danny Siegel.
Yeah, but I got to see if Adam did a video.
Oh, maybe.
I could be wrong, yeah. But that's funny because that looks like Adam's backdrop.
Hmm. Could be. Next one's from Danny as well. This one's called Sleeves. When your shoot requires gloves, but not sleeves.
Crushed it.
Well, those jeans also are jorts. See, the short, they turn into shorts.
Yeah,
dude.
You can easily take them off.
The best production cargo shorts ever. I'll fit like 50 Canon batteries when we go out. I look ridiculous, but they're the best.
Except for when
we're
in Poland.
Don't need legs on now.
All right, next.
Next one's from Derek Davies. This is Woolman Frodo.
That is old.
Woolman Frodo.
Imagine more. Be free.
Now women's can also shoot steady. Woolman Frodo. Available in pink and fluffy kitchen top models.
That is sexist, and I do not approve.
Oh, that's funny.
Next.
Next one's from Jay Prod. It's Lens Armstrong.
Nice guns, bruh.
Very clever.
That is good.
Next one is from John Nemesis. This is Raw Talk. You guys shoot JPEG. Get the... out of here.
That's funny.
Next one's from Cal Hill. This is the Intel Recovery album, where apparently I'm wearing a
Snuggie.
What's in your story, Snuggie?
But what's in your hand? Tissues?
You got tissues.
Are they happy tissues or sad tissues?
That's my stroke ghost.
All right, next.
Next one's from Randy B. This is Pluggy McPluggerson. Jared, it's time.
No more Pluggy McPluggersons now that I know how to obtain evidence in low-light situations.
Why do you look like a drug addict?
Because they pulled out the color.
Oh.
I think it might be a...
It looks like Charlie Gluten.
It might be that kind of a story going on.
Yeah, I get it. Next.
Next one's from Robbie Madden. This is my crap. I feel because I don't crap. That's all. That's next one's from Ross McCullough. Crushed it.
That's good.
And apparently I just used that one because he took advantage of the fact that if you put it in my gear vault, we're probably going to show it.
Yep.
Next one's from Seth Wade. It's Furnose Photo. I shoot roars.
So dumb.
Next one's from Stephen Hall. This is atmosphere. Taste the atmosphere, Stephen. All right, now we did actually get some audio singing this week.
Wow.
This one's from Barbara Kay. Spin that wheel.
All right, here we go.
Hey, assholes. It's Barbie Kay here. Long-time listener, first-time caller. I just wanted to let you know that that tube of meth you left out for me wasn't a tube of meth. And thank you for being the disposal center for my hypodermic needles. Anyway, it's time to spin that damn wheel, you assholes.
That's good.
There you go.
That's really good. If you guys, we used to do where people would submit things like this for spinning the wheel. We'd love to hear more of those.
Terry pretty much won that competition. That's the one we use now.
Oh, yeah.
But that one was good.
That was good. So here's another one from Pasco. It's spin, spin, spin that wheel.
All right, here we go.
Spin, 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 spin that wheel. Yeah.
I love that stuff. Man, please send in more of these. That's funny stuff.
Spin that wheel. Yeah.
All right, so that was the audio. Now, we did get a couple videos, but unfortunately, they used audio we can't really play on the show. Well, so I don't know if we can maybe put them on the site or something.
We'll try to put them on the site, froknowsphoto.com/rawtalk-214.
Because they're really good. They're very, funny. Very clever. They put a lot of work into them, but we just can't play them.
We'll find a way to post it or allow you to download it through a download link. So you can get them because they're funny.
You should check them out.
They are
you should
funny.
Definitely check them out. Go to what page?
I already just said that, Todd. Thank you for listening.
froknowsphoto.com/rawtalk-214.
Oh, I forgot.
I'm asking.
We got to pick a winner.
But keep in mind, in the future, just try not to use music.
Unless you make the music
yourself.
Unless
you make the music yourself,
Yeah, guidelines basically, music we can play or video we can play. Yeah. And try to put your name in the file. Yeah. Name as well.
Because it may be a parody and we may be technically legally allowed to use that music, but YouTube is very weird about that stuff.
It's tough. It's tough. Yeah.
All right. Let's pick a winner or two. I am a big fan of the Barb K audio.
Yeah.
They win something.
I really like Wool Man Frodo because I think a woman should only wear pink and stay in the kitchen. Thank you.
All right. I guess I pick one. Todd picks one. Now, Steven, you pick one.
I would love to pick one of those videos, but
so
I
pick
know
one
we
of the
can't.
Videos.
Yeah, pick one of the videos. Of the videos? Yeah.
Oh man, they're both good though.
One or the other.
I think the Frederico Fabre then.
Okay.
With the Frolling Stones.
All right. So
Frolling Stones. You'll
check
have
that
to go
out,
check
guys.
That on the website.
Yeah.
Those three people
that's
get
a good
it.
One.
So that's gonna take us to the end of the show.
Yeah.
Long show.
Yeah.
Well, actually, it's probably not that long. It's just a regular show. A
lot to catch up on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, yeah, as always, this is every other week now. You guys get to watch the show and enjoy the show, and we'll call it a show, and Jared's the show. And anything you guys want, any hashtags this week, Dan?
Oh, God.
He was ready.
He seriously was.
Steven, can you hand me the hashtags?
And now let's make fun of them.
Hashtag comb over nose photo. Hashtag never crop my photos. Hashtag chunky or smooth.
Ooh.
Hashtag prompter people. Shameless plug, Dan. Hashtag D3400 users got. No, that's lame. Hashtag hire me Gary V. No. Hashtag professional photographer. I will stick with hashtag comb over nose photo. Hashtag never crop my photos. Hashtag chunky or smooth. Thank you, Dan, for doing that. Now, we also filmed an interview with Shane Hurlbutt, who is an incredible filmmaker, DP.
Oh, yeah.
He's done a ton of music videos, done a ton of...
everything.
like new the movies. Skulls and what's the Terminator one? Terminator Salvation. He's done a
Activator with all the DSLRs,
which was the first feature film released shot only with DSLRs. But anyway, he was in here. It ended up being like an hour and 10 minute long interview. So
longest ever, by
if
the way.
On one of the weeks where we don't have Raw Talk, you may find an interview showing up in between big Raw Talk shows.
Bonus.
You may just find this interview on its own.
Yeah.
Because it's that good of an interview.
It's amazing.
Fantastic.
Shout
interview.
Out to Shane.
Yeah. Big shout out to awesome Shane. Dude. You can find him on YouTube to see the type of stuff that he does. Just give him a Google. His name's up on the screen. That's it. Let's get out of here.
Let's do it.
Episode 214 Raw Talk in the books. Jared Polin, FroKnowsPhoto.com. See ya.